But we only have 5 minutes left, and I wanted to end on a positive sort of note, because, you know, we drag you through a lot of trauma with this kind of presentation, and it is exhausting, I think. Hear one trauma story after another. So I like to end with the last 5 minutes of celebrating resilience. And each of us, I think, has our own resource of resilience. Mine is nature and water and mountains and music. Music's really important to me. It always has been, ever since I was small. Apparently I could sing songs before I could talk. Of course, I didn't talk till I was 18. No, that's not true. That's not true. I was born in Minnesota, and early on, I got very interested in jazz. I'm talking about when I was 10 or 12. And Minnesota is not the place to be if you're interested in jazz. And I was interested in Count Basie, Duke Ellington, you know, mostly black musicians. And there weren't any in Rochester, Minnesota, where I was from. So I used to listen to 78 RPM records of Count Basie and then 33 and a third, and listen to the blues. And Count Basie's band, particularly in the 50s, was my favorite. And Joe Williams, who was an incredible singer, and singers before. But the guitar player's name was Freddie Green. And I did everything that I could to emulate Freddie Green. When I went off to the East Coast to go to school, this was in 1957, and the Count Basie band came through, and I was playing with a jazz band by that time, playing jazz guitar. So we went down to listen to Count Basie, and none of us took a date. We didn't want to dance. We wanted to listen to Count Basie. We were all pressed up against the bandstand. And I was looking up at my hero, Freddie Green, who was playing kind of an up-tempo blues, and all at once, he lost his pick. And he couldn't find it anywhere. He was looking around his feet, picked up his guitar, was shaking it to see whether it had fallen down into one of the holes. Couldn't find it anywhere. But I had a pick. So I reached into my wallet, I pulled out this pick, and I reached up over the stage towards Freddie Green. You remember that scene from the Sistine Chapel? That's what it was like. I still have the pick. He gave it back to me. He's a very nice man. But in other words, Count Basie and the blues has been my kind of music. And I wanted to end with some of that. Why do I like the blues? There are all different kinds of music that I like. My classical music is gorgeous, some of it. Religious music puts you in touch with the divine. Ballads, and particularly love songs, put you in touch with something romantic, which we all appreciate. But I like the blues because the blues promises nothing but more trouble. The blues to me is really real. And I had a great quarrel once with a psychiatrist, at least over the email, who was from New Orleans, actually. And he felt that blues singers in New Orleans from the 20s and 30s and even before that were actually presenting in their music a distortion of what they were going through psychologically, because they must have had some sort of major depressive disorder. And I thought, oh my God, can you think of anything more insulting or off base to talk about something as wonderful as the blues as if it's pathologic or genetic, rather than understanding at some length about the oppression that these people were feeling and what was contained in the blues, the message of transcendence. And of course, the blues is full of humor. And people that really know how to sing the blues, they aren't blue. They have the blues. They have some control over this feeling, some distance from it, and are creative with it. And one of the greatest blues songs for me is Every Day I Have the Blues. And that's the one that it's almost my mantra when I'm really getting upset or I'm being confronted with something that's overwhelming is to begin humming that to myself. And it turns out that we have a 2-minute recording of Memphis Slim, who was the composer of Every Day I Have the Blues. This was a recording that was made in England in the early 1960s. And so I wanted all of us to watch this and to celebrate what his rendition is telling us, which is, I'm going to master this. I mean, everybody's left me. Nobody loves me. Nobody seems to care. But I'm going to pack up my suitcase and I'm walking on down the line because I could see myself in the future. I'm going to master this. I could get through it. And the importance of being able to instill that sort of attitude in people that we're working with psychologically that are stuck in terms of the golden thread, in terms of their future, getting engaged in something meaningful and being able to master all of this. So it's a nice way to end the day. So why don't we play that?
See you tomorrow morning.